Welcome to the talk on the paper, An Optimal Decentralized Data Plus 1 Coloring Algorithm. It is very well known that we can color any graph with Delta plus one colors. Here, we consider a decentralized algorithm to find such a coloring for a given graph. So we take any graph and initially we color each vertex independently and uniformly at random with one of these Delta plus one colors. Then we call all the vertices which are not happy yet, which have a neighbor with the same color, conflicted. And now we choose a conflicted vertex uniformly at random. Then we recolor this vertex, the chosen vertex, with a color uniformly at random. It can happen that we choose a color which immediately creates a conflict again, or we can actually also choose the same color we had before. In a sense, the vertex doesn't know its neighborhood, so it only knows whether there is a conflict. So then we repeat the last two steps until we find a proper coloring. So we pick a new conflicted vertex, recolor it, and so on until we call it converge to a proper coloring. So let us first look at a simple case. So if you look at the complete graph, the algorithm converges in order n log n. This can be seen as we actually, to finish, we need to have all the colors, which then is essentially the coupon collector process, because at each step we redraw one of the colors and we want to achieve all of them. And it is very well known that this takes order n log n time. And actually, in our case, this is also n log delta. And this second bound can be easily generalized to all pairs of delta and n. So if you look at the collection of clicks of size delta, then we know that for each of the clicks, we need delta log delta rounds to finish. And thus, in total, we have n over delta such clicks. We need n over delta times delta log delta, which is n log delta time to finish there and converge to proper coloring. So our main result in this paper is that this bound, which we saw here, is already can be tagged for all combinations of delta and n, is actually true as an upper bound for all graphs. So let me shortly talk about previous work. So Bartier et al. Introduced this algorithm and they proved an upper bound of order n delta rounds in expectation. And then Chakrabarty and Desupinski proved convergence in order n log delta for the persistent modification of the algorithm. The persistent modification of the algorithm is in this way that we choose a vertex and then we recolor this vertex over and over again until it has no neighbors of the same color. So in this paper, they also raised the question whether actually the variant of the algorithm we consider is actually also the same speed as theirs, or the same bound holds. And here in this paper, we proved that actually, yes, this bound also holds for the normal variant of the decentralized coloring algorithm. So for the most part of this presentation, I will now illustrate the main ideas of the proof. So main tool for the proof is drift analysis. And for those which are not familiar with drift analysis, I shortly give a very broad overview of what it is about. So I just put a sample theorem from there here. So in drift analysis, we often look at the stochastic process and a variable x, which is called the potential function, which tracks essentially the progress of our process. And so this x is chosen in this way that essentially when x is zero, we hit the goal of our process. And so we're interested in how long does it take to hit the goal. And what this theorem says, if we, in expectation, no matter where we are, we always drift at least delta in expectation towards zero or towards the target, then the expected time until we hit the target is at most the expected starting point, so x0, the expected value of x0 over the step size we actually take towards the target. And so essentially, if one looks at the stochastic process, one needs to find out a nice potential function which tracks the progress and actually has a nice drift towards the target, that we get a nice bound on the runtime. So this is what we will do now. We will build this potential function xt, which we used in the paper term by term, trying to give you some intuition why this potential function actually works. But before, we need to talk about more preliminary things. So to make the calculations and analysis easier, we change the view on the recalling step. So instead of picking a vertex which is completed uniformly at random, we first pick the monochromatic connecting component in which we then pick the vertex. So we pick a monochromatic connected component, which is essentially the components induced by the set of monochromatic edges, the edges which have two neighbors of the same size, the same color. And so what would happen here is that we pick this component with probability 3 over 7 and the other two monochromatic connected components with probability 2 over 7 each. And then after we picked the component, we then choose a vertex to recolor uniformly at random and recolor it randomly. So even though we picked the components at uniformly at random, because we picked the components in a weighted manner, we still essentially pick the vertex uniformly at random. So we do the same as before. And we also need some definitions. So PT denotes the set of properly colored vertices after step T. Additionally, MT denotes the set of monochromatic edges after step T. So all edges which have two endpoints which have the same color. Additionally, if a monochromatic edge has no incident edge which is also monochromatic, it is called isolated. So essentially, it forms a monochromatic connected component on its own. Then it is called isolated. And IT denotes the set of all isolated edges after step T. So after these definitions, we turn our attention to actually constructing this potential function. And so a very natural choice for the potential function would be we just count the number of edges which are still monochromatic. Because I mean, if we have no monochromatic edges left, then we are at zero, and so the target is at the right place. So the question then is, do we actually get a strong enough drift? Essentially, does the number of monochromatic edges go to zero fast enough in expectation that we get this drift? So let us look at the claim. So here, for any connected component we choose, so we condition on that we already know which component we choose, we get that the expected number of monochromatic edges after recoloring is at most the number of edges before recoloring minus the average degree of the component plus 1 minus 1 over delta plus 1. So to see this, so I mean, we choose the component and then we choose one of the vertices. And then with probability delta over delta plus 1, this vertex chooses a new color which is not the one in the component. And then all its neighbors, all the edges to its neighbors in the component are no longer monochromatic. And because we choose a uniform vertex in the component, on average, we remove delta d bar of c many edges in this way. But what can happen is that we actually create new monochromatic edges with other neighbors of the vertex which is recolored. And for that to happen, we actually need to choose exactly the color of a given vertex. And this happens with probability 1 over delta plus 1. And the delta minus the most delta minus the degree into the component neighbors, which can be this neighbor. And we again average over all possible choices in C, we get again this, we get this delta minus d bar of C. So note that because we pick monochromatic components with at least one edge, because otherwise it wouldn't be monochromatic anymore, this second and third term together are always at most zero. So we always get a drift of at least 1 over delta plus 1 towards zero. And this gives us a runtime of order n delta, which is also the proof Bertier et al. Did. I mean, to see this, one actually also needs to see that the expected value of monochromatic edges at the start is order of n, but this can be also easily seen. But let us look at this bound in more detail. So actually, if we have, we pick a large monochromatic component with at least, I mean, with at least three vertices, the average degree of this component is at least 4 over 3. So in this case, this bound here gives us a drift of at least 1/3 into the right direction. And if we always would pick components with at least three vertices, this would mean that we have a runtime of order n, because we have constant drift. But we can not hope that this is really the case, because we choose components randomly. So, but this already showcases the problematic case, actually, is that when we pick an isolated edge. So only these cases are actually a trouble for us. So because what could happen there is that essentially we have this edge, and then we recolor one of the vertices with another color, and then we just move the edge around. And so also the problem is essentially when we have many isolated edges and not too many large components. And so we look at I next. So here we have this claim. So we condition on the fact that we actually choose an isolated edge, and then the expected number of isolated edges after recoloring is at most the number of edges before recoloring minus delta over delta plus 1 plus this term here. So to see this, the first term, so essentially we pick one of the vertices, and then with probability delta over delta plus 1, it chooses a new color. So this isolated edge is not monochromatic anymore, and we remove one edge from I. But it might be that we actually create a new isolated edge. But for this to happen, we actually need to choose a color of a properly colored vertex. Because if the other, the new color is not there, we don't create any new monochromatic edges at all. And otherwise, we just add an edge to a larger component, and then it won't be counted in IT. And this gives us this bound on the right. So essentially, with probability 1/2, we choose the vertex U. And then we need to choose a color which is in the neighborhood of U, intersected with the properly colored vertices, and the same for W. And so, I mean, so essentially when this term is small, then this term dominates and we get a drift in the right direction, even if you pick a isolated edge as a component. And so this gives us the idea that we actually should combine these two terms, and then we get this term. So this 1 over 10 is chosen in such a way that if you pick a larger component, the drift of this term is still strong enough to cancel the drift which can happen here in the case for larger components in the wrong direction. I mean, this is in the paper and you can look it up there if you're interested why this works. So then is this term large and we don't actually get the drift. So this term is large when essentially both these terms are close to delta. So essentially when we have, we pick an isolated edge, where essentially all neighbors of the two vertices are properly colored. And so, I mean, so because we pick components uniformly, we pick components randomly, actually the case where we are in trouble with this potential would be where we have not many edges which are in large components or not many vertices which are in large components. So this means we have mostly isolated edges, and additionally we need that most of the isolated edges have most neighbors in P. So we're in this situation that we have essentially only isolated edges left and properly colored vertices left, and all the edges from these isolated edges go into the properly colored edges. So what happens in this case? So if we pick this vertex and recolor it, so what we expect to happen is that, okay, now it chooses a color out of here with large probability, so it creates a new isolated edge. But actually for this new conflicted vertex, we can make the following observation. So because all of these edges have most edges into P, we expect that actually this new conflicted vertex has quite some neighbors in I. And so this vertex before had essentially no neighbors in I, or at least not too many. And this one should have more because essentially we are in a situation where all edges from I go into P. And so we expect that the new vertex, which is conflicted, has fewer neighbors in P after as this red vertex, which is now not conflicted anymore. So in a sense, so in the case where the other terms of the potential fail to give a drift, we expect that actually we make the number of edges from I into P smaller. So we now add this term also to the potential function. So we add this last term, which has the proper constant that the drift in the other cases is still strong enough to make this not change anything for the other cases. But in the last case here, we get a drift. So this E is exactly this number of edges between P and the vertices of the isolated edges. So just to recap shortly. So if you pick a large component, we expect a strong drift in this term. Then if you pick isolated edges, which have many neighbors which are still not properly colored, we expect that we move the edge somewhere where it's not isolated anymore. So this term gets smaller. And in the last case, where essentially all neighbors of isolated edges are also properly colored, we decrease the number of edges between I and P. And so it turns out that this potential is actually enough to prove our theorem. And I just shortly put it up again. And additionally, in the paper, we show that for bipartite graphs, the algorithm converges in order of n steps instead of this order of n log delta steps. Additionally, we apply known tail bounds for these drift theorems, which we use to prove this theorem, to show that we not only get order of n log delta in expectation, but also with high probability. And one question one could ask is, so why do we color after each other? If we recolor all the conflicted vertices simultaneously, what happens then? And we show that actually then the process can take exponentially many recolorings. So it is really much slower than if we take turns in recoloring the vertices. So to finish the presentation, let me showcase two possible future questions. So in our proof, that the bipartite case needs order n recolorings, we can actually use the same proof to prove the same runtime bound for 1 minus epsilon times delta colors to choose from. So the question would be, how many colors are actually needed that we still get this runtime for the bipartite case? Because essentially we only actually need to color it, we would need only 2 colors, but the question is, how many colors does it need that this algorithm still works nicely? And this question can also be asked for other graphs where the chromatic number is much smaller than delta. And so also the same bound for the bipartite case showcases that actually our bound is not asymptotically tight for all families of graphs. And so it might be that we still can improve the upper bound. And one possible candidate would be order of n log chi, where chi is the chromatic number. I mean, this bound just matches all the runtimes of the algorithms where we know for special families of graphs. So thanks for your attention and have a nice day.